Well, good morning and welcome once again to Grace. Welcome all those in Norfolk, all those joining us from online. And many of us around here at Grace have been really excited about this sermon series called Supernatural, Empowered by the Holy Spirit. And I think one of the reasons why many of us have been looking forward to it is because we're going to be talking about the supernatural power of God and how through us, he can give us power, he can do miracles, he can change things. This stuff that we are really interested in. Maybe we want to learn more about it. Maybe we've experienced it in the past. We want to see it more a part of this community and more a part of our church experience. I know that for me, I've experienced those types of things in the past. I'd love to learn more about it. And so during Supernatural, we're going to tackle some of those things, including in the coming weeks. But I felt like as I was preparing our message for today, we needed to take a step back a little bit and remember who the Holy Spirit is. As we said, we're in this series, Supernatural, Empowered by the Holy Spirit. And I was just struck by the fact that this word holy is here before spirit. That he is the Holy Spirit, not just God's spirit, not just a general spirit, but he is a spirit of holiness. And so today I want to talk about this topic of holiness. I want to talk about how God is holy and his spirit is holy, but mainly I want to talk about how we as followers of Jesus can also be holy and how the Holy Spirit relates to that in and through us. And so let's just start by talking about this word holy and what does the word holy mean? And I want to refer you to some of modern day's most inspirational philosophers, Chance the Rapper and Justin Bieber. And so go ahead and take a listen to this song called Holy.
Touch it, it's making me say that the way you hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, feel so holy, 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 holy. Oh God, running to the altar like a track star, can't wait another second. There's a way you hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, feel so holy. I don't.
All right, that's enough. That's enough. Okay. So, yes. Applause for you for watching that. Okay. So, Justin Bieber in that song, the way you hold me, feel so holy on God, run into the altar like a track star, can't wait another second because the way you hold me feels so holy. I still can't decide whether the song is about God or about a girl or something, but if you know, just let me know after the service. I've literally studied the lyrics and I still can't tell. But what is Justin saying? What's he saying in that line? The way you hold me feels so holy. The way I'm held in this relationship, it feels sacred. It feels different. It feels special. It feels holy. And that is actually exactly the way that Scripture uses this word holy. When you are holy, when God is holy, it's talking about being set apart, being different, being sacred. And actually, this idea of holy mostly shows up in Scripture around the themes of temple and priests. So in the Old Testament, ancient Israel had this temple where God's presence was manifest and his glory was dwelling amongst the people. And they had priests who were about taking care of that temple. And a lot of times this idea of holy or consecrated or set apart takes place in this Jewish temple setting. Now, I want to show you this diagram that we talked about last week, showing that there is an old covenant experience of the Holy Spirit and a new covenant experience of the Holy Spirit. And you can imagine that because of how concentrated the Spirit's activity and the Holy Spirit's work was in the temple and through the priests and sometimes through kings or prophets, there was this almost diminished influence of the Spirit under the old covenant. But when Jesus died and rose again and at Pentecost sends his Spirit into his followers, there is a new experience of the Holy Spirit, not just centered on a place in Jerusalem, but actually throughout the New Testament, there's all this language that's applied to followers of Jesus. Did you know that we are called the temple of God because God's Spirit dwells within us? Did you know that we are called a chosen people, a royal priesthood? Every single follower of Jesus is a priest, not just certain people, all of us. Priests, all of us are God's temple. One of the most common terminologies used of followers of Jesus in the New Testament is saints. We are literally holy ones. And This is why I think one of the things we have to focus on as we talk about supernatural, as we talk about the Holy Spirit, is because this is kind of the main thing I would like for us to think about today. One of the most supernatural things that the Holy Spirit does is make us holy too. One of the most supernatural things, something that we don't earn, something that we couldn't do for ourselves, is the Holy Spirit makes us holy too. And I want to talk about two different aspects of holiness that the Spirit does in us and through us. And we're gonna see this by looking at some passages from the Apostle Paul, who was a leader in the early church. He went around to different cities throughout the Mediterranean world, and he planted churches and he wrote them letters. And we're gonna look at two different passages, one in Romans, one in 2 Corinthians, where he talks about the work of the Spirit and how it relates to our holiness. And so the first reality, the first aspect of holiness that I'd love for us to talk about is this really fun word, sanctification. Can you say sanctification? Sanctification is kind of a Bible word, but just so we're all on the same page as we get into this passage in Romans, sanctification is to be set apart by God and made truly holy by his grace. So to be sanctified is to be made holy. To sanctify something is to set it apart, to make it holy. And that's what the Holy Spirit has done for you if you've put your faith in Jesus. Let's read in Romans chapter 15. Paul says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." Paul here is speaking to the Roman church and saying, what's going to happen by the power of the Holy Spirit? What is the Holy Spirit going to do among you? Yes, he's going to do miracles. Yes, he's going to give you abilities and capacities that you couldn't have otherwise without the supernatural power of God. And yet, if you read Scripture again and again and again, the Holy Spirit shows up with these words like hope and peace and joy. The Holy Spirit is working holiness in us, and our character is being changed to have these qualities of joy and peace and hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Paul continues in verse 14, "I myself am convinced, my brothers and sisters, that you yourselves are full of goodness, filled with knowledge, and competent to instruct one another." Paul's saying, the power of the Holy Spirit is at work in your midst, in your community. You have joy and peace and hope. You're also full of goodness. You have knowledge. You're competent to instruct one another. The Holy Spirit is more than just this force or this power that God gives us to do things. No, he makes us into certain kinds of people who are full of goodness. And Paul alludes to it in the next verse, verse 15, that this is all by God's grace. "Yet I have written to you quite boldly on some points to remind you of them again because of the grace God gave me to be a minister of Christ Jesus to the Gentiles." Paul's saying, your character, your holiness, your joy, your peace, your goodness, all of it is by the grace of God, by the Spirit of God, and even my ministry to the Gentiles is by the grace of God. Now, Gentiles is just a fancy word for someone who's not Jewish. And if you remember, when Paul starts his ministry, almost every single Christian in the world is either ethnically or religiously Jewish. And so he's going out to these people who have no idea what he's talking about, have no idea about the temple, have no idea about priests in terms of the way Israel understood it. And so he's going out with this message of grace, message of Jesus. And then we get to verse 16, which is kind of the one that I want to really highlight today. Paul describes his ministry to the Gentile world. And he says, "He gave me the priestly duty of proclaiming the gospel of God so that the Gentiles might become an offering acceptable to God, sanctified by the Holy Spirit." Sanctified by the Holy Spirit. First thing I want us to see is all of this temple language that's coming up for Paul here. It is his priestly duty. He's bringing the Gentiles that they might be an acceptable offering to God. Again, priests, offerings, this is temple stuff, sanctified by the Holy Spirit. And what Paul is doing here is he's bringing up this image of the Gentile, the non-Jew, someone who's not under the Jewish law, someone who doesn't understand what it looks like to follow God, to follow the God of Israel, to follow the God of Scripture, the God who created all things. And he's saying, how can these people who are so unholy, so different, so other, not followers of God, how can they be an offering acceptable to God? Well, they've been sanctified by the Holy Spirit. They've been made holy and set apart by the Spirit. this brings up sort of a way that we think about sanctification sometimes. If you've been around and you're familiar with that concept or that word, maybe you've thought about sanctification mainly as a process. Like I'm saved by Jesus and by his grace, and then I work out this sanctification process where I'm made more and more holy. Actually, throughout the New Testament, when this language of sanctification or sanctified is used, it's almost always a past completed action that the Holy Spirit has already done in you. And this makes sense if you think about it. All of us who are followers of Jesus, we have, in some ways, a fairly casual relationship with God. He's our Father. We can pray to him whenever we want. We sang songs today inviting his presence into the room, into our hearts. How can we do that if we weren't holy already? You get to pray to God for a parking spot, right? I mean, like, we get to do that. Do you realize what the Jewish people had to do in order to come before this holy God and his presence and his glory, the stipulations, the leadership, the anointing oil, all those things? And we have this access to God. It's incredible. It literally changed history, this new covenant experience of God. And yet, we could not do it if we weren't holy yet. We couldn't relate to God in that intimate way. We couldn't pray to him and expect our prayers to be heard if God hadn't already, by his Spirit, through faith in Jesus, unleashed himself and his power into our hearts and our lives to make us holy. We've been set apart. We've been sanctified. And one of the most supernatural things the Holy Spirit does is sanctify us, make us holy, make us an acceptable offering, as it says, to God. Now, this understanding of sanctification actually changes how you relate to your Heavenly Father. Because if you are already holy, if Jesus and his work and his sacrifice has already made you enough, then you relate to God in a different way. You don't have to earn anything. Sanctification goes from a guilt word that is just all the ways you don't measure up to a grace word. You've been given something by God, and it changes how you relate. And it reminds me of how we sometimes misunderstand sanctification and the implications that has in our communities. So as we talk about the Holy Spirit and we talk about the holiness of the Spirit and how he makes us holy, it makes me think a lot of the different spiritual leaders and Christian leaders and church leaders who've had incredible moral failings, whose integrity has not stood up to the test, who have not been walking in a way that's holy or reflects God. And it has completely blown up lives and families and churches. It's incredibly sad. And I think one of the ways that that happens is we're all imperfect people, right? We all fail, we all make mistakes, and maybe we push an envelope here, or we go into something that we know is wrong. And yet, what makes us stay hidden in that place? What makes us take the next step and the next step? What makes it go from just a one-off mistake to something 5 years later, I'm still in the midst of this dark, hidden thing that no one else knows about? I think this doctrine of sanctification and understanding that we in Jesus have been made holy allows us, when we mess up, when we find ourselves caught in sin, when we find ourselves in a place we don't want to be, we can walk towards the light. We can confess it to somebody we trust. We can face those consequences that may be there. Because it doesn't mean God's going to take away the consequences of those actions and of those mistakes, but it does mean there's grace and there's forgiveness, and he's going to be with you as you walk out what that means for you. I want this community, I want Grace Bible Church to be a safe place, to be a place where you don't have to be afraid to come with what's real. And I'll just challenge you, particularly if you're a leader in our church, if you lead a community group, if you lead kids and students, if you lead a ministry or a team, if you're on staff, if you're a pastor here at Grace, and there's something hidden or dark in your life that no one else knows about, that you know there's something coming, consequences-wise, for this, there's grace. You've been sanctified. If you put your faith in Jesus, you can walk towards the light. And again, it doesn't mean there won't be consequences to face. But will those consequences be any less a year from now? Or is it going to get worse? Is it only going to go further? Is it only going to get darker? And so if you find yourself in a place where you're addicted to pornography or alcohol, if you find yourself in a place where you've been unfaithful in your marriage, maybe you've been dishonest with money, walk towards the light. Tell somebody, tell that person that you don't want to tell, and start to make amends. And start to lean into this reality that you have been forgiven and you have received grace, and so you can walk towards the light and face whatever it is you need to face because of Jesus, because we've been sanctified. Sanctification is something we rest in. It's a position that we have before God. And so the question becomes, how does the Bible talk about the process of becoming more holy? Because none of us, maybe objectively before God because of Jesus, we're holy in his sight, but we're all imperfect. We all mess up. We all don't do it right all the time. And so how do we talk about this process of growth in our faith? Well, I think the word that's most used for this reality is transformation, actually. Transformation, progressively becoming more and more holy as you follow Jesus. So if holiness is a position, we've been sanctified and made holy, holiness is also a process. We are being transformed to become more and more holy. Holiness is something that we rest in, our sanctification. Holiness is also something that we run after, our transformation. This is a place that we participate with the Holy Spirit in his work in us. And one of the main places this comes up is in the book of 2 Corinthians, another letter of Paul, and he writes in verses 15 and 16 of chapter 3, even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. We've kind of jumped right into the middle of this argument that Paul has been building to say that the old covenant under Moses is not as good as the new covenant under Jesus. And he references this idea of Moses having a veil. And this is a story from Exodus where Moses meets face to face with God. And when he goes back to the people, he's radiating glory because of all that God has shown him. And so he has to wear a veil over his face because literally the Israelites can't look at him directly. There's so much glory. There's so much radiance. They can't handle it. And Paul is saying, because all of us, every human being is sinful, every single human being is so other than the holiness of God, we can't look directly at the glory or radiance of God either, especially under the old covenant. And yet, when we turn to the Lord, the veil is taken away. When you turn to Jesus, when you put your faith in his death and his resurrection, the veil goes away and you can actually look face to face with God and see his glory and see what he is like and experience his holiness in a way that doesn't consume you and doesn't sweep you away, but you can be there and you can view it. That's what happens when you turn to the Lord. And when it says turn to the Lord, I read that and I thought, oh, he's talking about Jesus. Oftentimes when he says the Lord, he's talking about the Lord Jesus, but he actually is talking about the Holy Spirit. You can see this in the next verse, verse 17. Now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There's freedom. So as we rest in our sanctification, we've been made holy, and as we run after transformation and being more and more holy in our lives, there is freedom because the Holy Spirit is there, and he is the one who brings divine glory and radiance into our lives. He is the one who transforms us. If you want to know where freedom is, if you want to know where you can experience the divine nature, it's wherever the Spirit of God is and turning to him. And it leads to this last verse, which we're going to spend most of our time on, verse 18. And we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Now, you see this glory language coming up again. This is, again, temple language, the glory of God dwelling amongst his people. And as we, with unveiled faces, through the Spirit's glory, through Jesus' glory, are being transformed into the image of God. You have been made holy, but you also are being made holy. And this is a transformation. This is a process. You haven't been transformed yet. It hasn't happened yet. It is not completed. It will happen one day, fully and finally, but you are in process. You are in the middle of that happening. Paul also says that this transformation is with ever-increasing glory. Maybe your translation might say from glory to glory. This almost upward trajectory of being more and more like Jesus, looking more and more like God, experiencing more and more holiness and glory in your life. One of the most supernatural things the Holy Spirit does is he transforms us. He transforms us and makes us holy through a process. Now, if you're here and maybe you've been walking with God for a while and you haven't seen this reality really play itself out. Maybe you feel the same that you always were. Maybe it's been years and you don't feel like you've grown at all. Maybe you feel like you've just been living in the status quo. A few things I would just offer to you today. The first one is this is a work that we, of course, cooperate with the Spirit. We participate with the Spirit in our own transformation. He nudges us. He calls us to obedience, to steps of faith. But ultimately, this is the work of the Spirit. This is a supernatural reality that's happening in your life. It's not about feelings. It's not about what you can always see. But with eyes of faith, we can see how supernaturally the Spirit is doing things in our lives that maybe we aren't taking notice of. And then the second thing I would offer to you is not only is this a supernatural process that happens through God's Spirit, but this is a process that oftentimes takes longer than we think. The Holy Spirit is powerful. He can change something with a lightning bolt. He can change you, heal you, deliver you, transform you in an instant if he wants to. But I would say most often the Spirit is less like a microwave and more like a crock pot, okay? So the Holy Spirit is not about superficial, instantaneous change most of the time. Again, he can do that. Most of the time, it's time in the Spirit, time in the Word, time in community, time facing your brokenness, time struggling and facing those things that hold us back, and God working supernaturally in the midst of it as we trust Jesus more and more. The Holy Spirit, I use this, people caught on this one last service, but the Holy Spirit doesn't make chicken nuggets, okay? He's all about the rotisserie, all right? He's like slow cooked, slow roasted. It takes a while, and this is something that we struggle with more than almost any generation or time period in history, this idea of things taking a while. We overestimate oftentimes what we can do in the short term, and we underestimate what we can do in the long term. We overestimate what we think can happen in a week, but we underestimate what can happen in a year or what could happen in a decade. Oftentimes, when you look at spiritual transformation and holiness in your own life, you have to look at a decade more so than you can look at just a few weeks of time. Ask people around you to tell you if they see you changing, if they see that glory coming. And then be encouraged that God is at work in your life and he is guiding you through this process. Now, as we pursue holiness, as we continue to experience that glory more and more in our lives, there's a few things that are gonna happen that I think make it worth it to wait, make it worth it to be patient, make it worth it to day after day continue to take those steps of faith and steps of obedience. And I just wanna share those with you as we begin to close. If you experience greater holiness in your life, here's a few things that are gonna happen. You're gonna have greater intimacy with God. You're gonna have greater connection with your Heavenly Father. Doesn't mean you earn your relationship with God, but Jesus said it like this: blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. There's something about sin, there's something about unholiness or rebellion in our own lives and our own hearts that makes the picture of God blurry for us. He's still there, he's still turned towards us, but we don't sense his presence in the same way, and we don't sense that connection in the same way. So I'd encourage you to think about what would it look like to pursue holiness in your life and what things are maybe keeping you from a clear, intimate picture of God. Maybe it's a Netflix show that you've been watching or an HBO Max show. Maybe it's the habit of scrolling Instagram. I don't know what it is, but there are things that let stuff into our lives that keep us from that intimate relationship with God. But the more that you pursue purity and holiness, the more you'll experience that intimacy. And the second thing that you'll experience the more you pursue holiness is a greater impact with the gifts of the Spirit. A greater impact with the gifts of the Spirit. Now, don't get me wrong, God can use anyone. He can use a pagan emperor. He can use a hypocritical preacher. He can use a donkey, as we saw in Scripture. But if you pursue Jesus, if you pursue holiness, the more that you are set apart, the more that your life looks different from people around you, the more that you are going to be a vessel for God's power to work through you. I think about some of these spiritual leaders who have fallen from grace, who've had incredible moral failures. And maybe God used them in mighty ways. Maybe they did miraculous things. Maybe they just led at this level or spoke in a way that changed people's lives. That's true. God can do that through people who are broken and failures. And yet, how much more would God have used them? How much more would the power of God have been at work through them as vessels of his grace to others if they had pursued holiness? And it's the same for us. It's the same for us. So, holiness, it's a position. Sanctification, it's a process. Transformation. You have been made holy. You are being made holy. You already are holy. You're not yet all the way there, but you're getting there from glory to glory. And so together as a community, let's continue to pursue what it looks like to pursue holiness. And two of the ways that we're offering during this sermon series, one of them is Sunday at 7. Tonight, it's going to be at the Norfolk campus. Would encourage you to come out. Last week here at the Lynnhaven campus, we had an amazing time. There were about 100 people there. God was moving. People were praying. Would love to see you tonight at 7. I don't think the snow is not going to stick even if it's there. So 21 Days with the Holy Spirit. This is a devotional process. You can still sign up. It'll start from the beginning. If you go to gracebible.church/spirit21, we would love for you to walk with us as we open ourselves up more and more, not just to the power of the Spirit at work through us in these miraculous ways, but the Holy Spirit wants to work in us. One of the most supernatural things he does is change us and make us holy too. And so, as we close, would you pray with me? Father, thank you for your grace. Thank you that none of this talk of holiness or purity or obedience could happen without your grace at work in us. Lord, we open ourselves up. We invite you in. Thank you that we can even do that, that we can even invite you in, a holy God, to dwell with us, to love us, to relate to us. Lord, draw close in this time. Draw close in this season in the life of our church. And would you continue to transform us into the people who reflect your holiness and your goodness to the world. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.